Morning. How's everybody doing? I don't want it to be very exciting today. Just don't anybody get excited. Isn't it funny how a tone of voice will change everything? Let's start over. Good morning. How is everybody? All right. Anthony, I'm glad to see you made it. Mom, good to have you here. God bless you. It's great to be here at Archie's. A nice sunny day. It was supposed to be, what, 103 today? No? It feels like it. Anyway, we got a lot going on. For those of you who are not aware and not on Facebook, Sam and Rhonda packed their bags and headed back to Palm Beach on Friday. They just had some job changes and some health issues, so they went back and they're going back to Palm Beach, back where their home is. And so if you want to catch up with him on Facebook or drop him an email, you can do that. If you have his phone number, you can give him a call. But anyway, just want to let you know that change happened. The stuff at the thrift store is amazing me. Everything's changing every other day. We're getting new stuff in, new stuff out. If you haven't been to the thrift store in a few weeks, you're missing something. Don't come in Tuesday because the door is full of stuff. I went and got 3 trailer loads of stuff yesterday. And I'm exhaustipated. Can everybody say that? Exhaustipated. Yeah. I don't know what it means, but I feel it. What's that? Oh, it's tired and constipated. All right, so it's accurate. And where's Ophelia? Ophelia. Where are you, Opie? Come on, Opie. Opie's back there. Opie started her Tuesday and Thursday night Bible studies again. So if you want to get involved with her Bible study Tuesdays and Thursdays, I think she starts at 7 and goes to like 2 a.m. Close. No, but she's got a very in-depth Bible study. That's Tuesdays and Thursdays. Look on the back of your bulletin. And I want to let you know that we have 2 more weeks. And I did not change this. This Wednesday is step 11. Next Wednesday is step 12 of Recovery and Grace, and then we are starting back class 1 of the Alpha Series. I cannot. Did you do that 3 times?
I'm behind you.
All right. I cannot express enough how I would love for each and every one of you to commit to a 9-week course and study the Alpha Series more than once. Because it's that good of a study, in my opinion, it's changed my life. If you can start on this coming Wednesday, if we have to drag out another 30 or 40 chairs into the thrift store, we'll do it. But I think it's very important that each of you discover this teaching for yourself. That being said, let's open up with a word of prayer. We are still collecting food for the homeless, whether they come into the thrift store or I take it to the college. Works both places. We're still accepting all kinds of donations at the thrift store. And if you're pulling pull tabs off of your soda cans or other beverages, I'm not going to figure out what you're drinking. Doesn't matter. If it comes off a dog food can, pull tabs. We're still collecting those to bring to the college, and those help the Ronald McDonald House, and they help us gain points at the Human Services Club at the college. So those are 3 things that we're still doing. And what else? We'll open with a word of prayer and move forward. Oh, where are you? Ed. Hey, Ed. He's not listening to me, is he? Is that Ed? His name's... Oh, there he is. I'm looking at the wrong Ed. Ed wanted me to remind you of Monday men's breakfast at the Potbelly Deli, 7 a.m., and Wendy looks like she has something to say. Oh, Paver. See Wendy... about the pay. Don't look at me in that tone of voice. You're the one who brought it up. If you want to get one of the pavers, we really got to put those orders together and get them into Patty and put the funds together. But the pavers, basically, if you're getting a base paver, where Patty has them at $100, and then if you add a logo, it's $125. But see Wendy about filling out a form, because she brought it up. I'm leaving it in her court, and I'm exhausted, and I don't want to talk to you about it. But I will if I have to. The pavers are for Patty here at Archie's. They're going to start paving a motorcycle area here, and that'll help her with the funding of covering the rest of the parking lot with whatever she has to do, whether it's asphalt or whatever. Let's get into this. Father, I, for one, am exhausted, but I'm not tired of ministry, but I do get tired in ministry. God, I ask you for your rest right now. I ask you for the rest of those who are weary from all the things that we do in the world and the things that we do in the mission field. You're the reason that we can keep on plugging away and keep on doing your job when we're called to share the truth. It is not only restful, but it's freeing. So today, as we share the truth in song and in word, we ask you to just touch our hearts, to wake us up, and to keep us moving forward, knowing that you are the power behind all that we do. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. Page 121. The rest of the songs are on the front of your bulletin, and the songbooks are at the offering tables. Tasha. Tasha. For those who sign.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord.
Oh, Lord.
Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
You know it now. Come on, sing along.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord.
Oh, Lord.
Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you.
Lord,
I want to see you.
High and lifted up.
To see you high and lifted up. Shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. High and lifted up. Shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy.
Say that with us three times, holy, holy, holy. Over and over and over until you get tired of it. Do it again. Ready? Holy, holy, holy. Here we go.
Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. I want to see you. Holy, holy,
you are
holy, holy, holy,
Jesus.
Holy, 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 I want to see you.
I need you to keep singing real strong.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. To see you.
Keep going, I need you.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. Lord, I want to see you.
Two more times.
Holy, holy, holy.
You are
holy, holy, holy. To see you.
One more. Good job. Thank you. I don't know what she was signing at me earlier, but I got my feelings hurt. Only because I didn't know.
My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength, let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the works of your hands. Forever I love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you. Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days, I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength. Let every breath and all that I am never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hand. Forever I love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you. Shout to the Lord, earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the works of your hand. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have. No, nothing compares to the promise I have. Oh, nothing compares to the promise I have in you.
Sometimes that's all the only way we make it through the week, right? That's knowing right. That there's hope. My Redeemer lives right here inside me.
I know you're resting my soul. All right. believe. I believe. My shame he's taken away. My pain is healed in his name. I believe.
How about you?
I believe. I'll raise the banner. My Lord is conquered the grave. My Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives.
All right, let's see if we can start out a little stronger this time. You ready?
I know he rescued my soul. His blood has covered my sin. I believe.
Yeah.
I believe. All my shame he's taken away. All my pain is healed in his name. I believe.
Yeah.
I believe.
What you gonna do about it?
I'll raise a banner. The grave, my Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives.
He lives inside.
My Redeemer lives.
To lead and guide.
My Redeemer lives. 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 You lift my burden, I'll rise with you. I'm dancing on this mountaintop to see your kingdom come. My Redeemer lives, my Redeemer lives, my Redeemer lives, my Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives.
What you say?
My Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives.
One more time.
My Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives.
Ah, is that what that is? That's applause? Oh, nice. And a hush came over the crowd. All right, how great is our God anyway? Anybody know?
Awesome.
I think he is. He's been great in my life. 64.
The splendor of the King
is cooking now.
Let all the earth rejoice. Let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me. How great is our God? And all will see. How great, how great is our God. Age to age he stands. In his hands, beginning and the end.
three in one. Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God.
Everybody sing with me.
How great is our God,
so that the world will see.
How great, how great is our God.
Keep singing that, I need you again. Don't give up now.
How great is our God.
Come on people, sing with me.
How great is our God,
so that the world will see.
How great.
Voices all unite and the music's tight and sounds all right and it's dynamite. Hey, that sounds like Guitar Zan to me. Good job, girls. Good job, Tasha. You want to stay up here with me for the message? Cool. All right. Well, it's been a long, hard, hot week and a lot going on. Wendy's going to take the kids into the air-conditioned kids camper. Did you hear that, guys? Air-conditioned. You with me? He's not paying attention. Hello? Hey, you three. Yeah. Oh, they're too big for kids. Okay, you guys are too big. Good. Order them breakfast. Anyway, all right, so Wendy's going back there. Next week, we won't have the camper, I don't believe, because we're going to put it up for repairs. Need some help. All right, so this week, I'm going to call Bob up early because I'm exhausted. Come on, Bob. I need a break. Where'd he go? All right. Calling all Bobs, calling all Bobs. Car 54, where are you? From 1954, 64. Anyway, we're working on the second book of Acts, and I'm just ready to drop out. I need to go get some water, so I was going to get Bob up here and get him started, and then I'll come back.
All righty, you bet. Good morning. Rolling right along here. Hey, I'm excited to hear Dave's announcement that he's starting an Alpha series. I really encourage you, as strong as I can, if you have not taken that class, find out about it yourself, because I can tell you about it till I'm blue in the face. It won't mean anything to you unless you experience it. It's a way to apply the gospel of grace to your life and to come to some deep understandings about what drives your thinking, what drives your behavior, and what your real identity in Christ, what that really means. Some of us have an idea that God's got us, but we don't know how good the good news really is. And the Alpha series opened that up to me. So if you're in recovery, it's good. If you're not in recovery, it's good. I can tell you this, it has nothing to do with addiction and that kind of thing. Some people think because we've used it in a rehab kind of setting that it's for those people. But let me tell you, it's for everybody that was born in the flesh, and that was you and me. I'm jealous because he's teaching it again, but I can't because I'm doing an internship. However, I did talk to the owner of the rehab that I'm doing my internship at, and he's considering doing a faith-based track. And I said, if you do, I want in. I want in because the Alpha series will be part of that curriculum. If I have anything to do with it, it's that good. So we are in the second chapter of Acts. And how appropriate, you know. All this week, what I've been in talking with other people and what God's been hitting me with is just walking in the Spirit, just showing up, not trusting in our own understanding or how we're going to figure things out, but show up. I started the day before yesterday with this message and a little story I read, just show up. And then the last, at 9 o'clock at night before I left my internship, talking with one of the counselors, the same message I got was, just show up. God's got you. Whatever you're doing, wherever you are, just show up because God's got you. And when we learn to yield to Him, it's not about what we know. It's not about our capabilities. It's not about us being all that. It's about yielding to God and allowing His Spirit to work through us in this world. And it's so needed more than ever today. So in Acts chapter 2, the day of Pentecost has arrived. And Jesus had told them to wait in Jerusalem until the promise of the Father came. And it says they were all with one accord, the apostles, the 12. They were all of one accord. That means they were together in unity. They had different personalities. They were different people, but they were all together with one common theme, the Lord Jesus Christ, and being yielded to Him in one place. And I highlighted this twice with different colors, all with one accord, because remember, the disciples were childish at times with Jesus. He would be teaching them great truth, and they were arguing amongst themselves over who would be the greatest in the kingdom. Time and again we saw it. We saw it at the Last Supper. What an important event. And they were arguing amongst themselves, who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom? Well, something's changed. They've been transformed. And they're with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Some may think it was a wind. It wasn't a wind. It was like a wind. It was a loud noise. And it was, not only did they hear it, but it was heard all over Jerusalem. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one set upon each of them. It would be like seeing these 12 men sitting there, and there appeared what looked like an individual flame. You hear this rushing wind, and then there's this flame appearing, what it looks like, over each one of them, right over their heads. And they were filled with the Holy Spirit, and they began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And what does this mean, speaking with tongues? Well, in this case, what it means, they spoke in other languages. And there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And when the sound occurred, the multitudes came together, and they were confused because they heard this loud rushing noise. And they come and they find the apostles, and they have these flames, what look like over their heads, and they're speaking in different languages. Now, these men, it says, these people that came were from different countries, and they heard them in their own language. Then they were all amazed and marveled, saying one to another, "Look, are not all these who speak Galileans? How is it that we hear each in our own language in which we were born? Parthians and Medes and Elamites, those dwelling in Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, I don't know how to pronounce this one, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt, and parts of Libya. Listen, there were three continents of all the known world. Men from Africa, Europe, and Asia, and other Middle Eastern countries. And they're listening to these men from Galilee who spoke one language, yet they're speaking in all these languages in an understandable way." Wow. So, listen to what they said. "We hear them speaking in our own tongues the wonderful works of God." That's what they were speaking. Not gibberish noise that no one knew. They were speaking of the wonderful works of God as the Spirit filled them. This is what the day of Pentecost is about. See, it's changed. In the old covenant, God's Spirit would come into the holy of the holy places in the temple, and only the high priest once a year could go have contact, unless at certain times a spirit happened to come and move a person. But that would seem to be very rare. Now Jesus comes and he talks about the kingdom of heaven and how he's one with the Father and how he came to save us. And he's returned to the Father, and now on the day of Pentecost, you got to realize that these Hebrew feasts and special holidays in the Old Testament, they spoke of Christ. All the way back in the Old Testament, what was the Passover about when they were still slaves in Egypt? The Passover represented the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. The Feast of the First Fruits in the Old Testament represents the resurrection of Christ. Remember, Christ is the first fruits. Then we too will be raised up into the next life. And then Pentecost. When I was researching this, and I was listening to J. Vernon McGee, who I often go to. He's my go-to guy when I want to really study Scripture on your own and then go do some research. See what God gives you directly, then see what he'll give you through other people. The Pentecost, he said, represents the birth of the church. The Spirit has come. Remember, the church is a living organism. You've heard Dave say that many times. What does he mean by that, a living organism? It's the body of Christ manifested in this world. And Christ birthed that into this world on the day of Pentecost. The Spirit came. Others mocked them and said, "They're full of new wine." In other words, they're drunk on the cheap stuff. They thought, this doesn't make sense. They didn't understand it. This is too wild. They were probably very animated because they were joyful, being filled with the Spirit and speaking in all these languages. But Peter, standing there with the 11, raised his voice. You're going to hear the first sermon in the first church gathering. He said, "Men of Judea and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and heed my words. For these are not drunk as you may suppose, for it is the early hours of the morning." He's saying they're not drunk. They're not drunk. He says, "But this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel." And in the scripture that he gave back from the Old Testament, it talks about God pouring out his Spirit on that day. He says, "And it shall come to pass in the last days, says God, that I will pour out of my Spirit on all flesh, your sons and your daughters." Men and women, see, God doesn't discriminate. That's a man-made thing. Past repression of women and that kind of thing. That was man-made. That wasn't God's way. He says, "On my sons and my daughters, I'm going to pour out my Spirit." This was prophesied through the prophet hundreds of years before, and it's came to pass, and it's still being fulfilled today. God's still pouring out his Spirit. Peter went on, he said, "Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God, by miracles, wonders, and signs which God did through him in your midst, as you also know, him being delivered by the determined purpose and foreknowledge of God, you have taken by lawless hands and crucified and put to death." He hits him straight. Some of the same people are there witnessing this, that just less than 2 months before had crucified the Son of God. So he tells them straight. He wasn't about political correctness or tickling ears or trying to make people feel good just to make them feel good so he could be popular. He tells them the truth. "Whom God raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it was not possible that he could be held by it." He said, "You did your best. You killed him. God raised him up. He is the Son of God." And he quotes more prophecy. See, these were Jews. This church was birthed in Jerusalem. It started in Israel. This is where the church was started. It isn't out to the Gentiles yet. That's about to come. And he quotes from a psalm. And I think it might be Psalm 18, but there's a lot of the Psalms that have prophecies of Jesus. And he talks about, well, I'll read it to you, this prophecy that was fulfilled, just a part of it. He said, "For you will not leave my soul in Hades, nor will you allow your Holy One to see corruption. You have made known to me the ways of life. You will make me full of joy in your presence." That's what David wrote back in the old covenant days. He's saying, "I know I'm going to die. I'm going to be in Sheol. But you're not going to leave me in the grave. You're going to raise me up." David knew that because God was going to send a Messiah to save his people, that he would be saved too. See, in the Old Testament, they could believe in the Savior that was to come. Today, we are privileged to believe in the Messiah that came and saved us and saves us today. Yielded to the Spirit. Be willing to show up. Are you willing to show up for life? Submitted to God? Or do you want to just figure this life thing out on your own and do it your way? It's up to you. You know, it didn't work for me, and I continue to find out when I try it, it doesn't work for me. But when I yield to God and when I show up, he makes it work. It's the Spirit. It's his Spirit alive today. This Jesus God, he goes on, has raised up, of which we were all witnesses, being exalted to the right hand of God and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit. He poured this out that you now see and hear. And he's pouring it out today. This same Jesus. When you're moved in the Spirit, it's him that does it. This isn't something you can do on your own, or I can do on our own. It's not about an emotional high, although sometimes that comes. Sometimes it doesn't. But it's real. And it changes us completely. "Therefore," he says, "let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ." And when they heard this, it says they were cut to the heart. "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" And Peter says to them, metanoia, repent. Change your thinking. Doesn't say go out and change your behavior and try to get good enough for God. Not at all. It says change your thinking. "And let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins." What does remission mean? It means take away. He takes away our sins. Gone. Doesn't just whitewash them. put them in a closet. And this is what we do sometimes. Put them in a closet and then bring them back out so we can shove them in somebody's face. You know, we'll put other people's sins in closets. We're good at that, aren't we? And then when we're in argument, but you, and we bring them out. That's not what God does. That's not God's way. As Jesus came, Peter said, for the remission, the taking away of sins, freedom. This is real freedom. And you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. There's the promise. There's the reality. Turn your life and will over. Receive the baptism. Receive the Spirit. It's promised to us as believers. He promises us to us. He says, for the promise is to you and to your children and to all who are far off, as many as the Lord our God will call. Is he calling you? Is he calling you today? Have you resisted it? Paul writes in two places. One place, I think, is Ephesians. Dave will know. The other one's in Thessalonians. He says, don't grieve the Spirit. Don't sit there and, I don't know if I want to yet, maybe someday. When the Spirit's calling you, it's time. And don't quench the Spirit. Quenching the Spirit. Don't listen to what other people say about it. Go with what God gives you. Wow. This is Spirit stuff here. Promise to you and your children. And with many other words, he testified and exhorted them, saying, be saved from this perverse generation. And it is a perverse generation that we live in today. There's a lot of horrific things happening in the world. People in other lands, their children being slaughtered because their children are so one with Jesus that they won't deny him. I'm not into guilt trips, but I have to put it on myself. Sometimes I don't want to get up and go work today. I'd rather just be lazy today. I got to go do it. And there's people that don't have a thermostat to turn up a few degrees, a refrigerator to get something to eat out of, and yet they are giving their lives up for Jesus. Not only those being executed, but those that are working in places where it's dangerous, where Christianity isn't accepted, but they're there pouring their lives out to minister to those that are in danger, putting themselves in harm's way because they've yielded to God, because they know what's truly important. It's about loving other people, whatever people it is that God puts on your heart to love. And with many other words, he testified, and he said, and it says that those who gladly received his word were baptized, and that day about 3,000 souls in this ancient city of Jerusalem. 3,000 souls were saved that day. Holy Spirit fire. Those 12 men couldn't have done that, going out, giving tracts out. Are you saved, brother? Do you know the way to heaven? Do you have a relationship with Jesus? Let me tell you how. That wouldn't have worked. The Holy Spirit arranged this, but they were there of one accord, focused on Jesus, and Jesus brought this about. Being willing, submitting, being filled. See, that's the other part. Be filled with the Spirit. And being filled sounds like not something that you go do. It says don't go fill yourself up with the Spirit. It's not what it says. Fill yourself up. It says be filled. Allow it to happen to you. It's a passive thing. You allow. You put your own little agenda away, and you say, thy will be done. I want you. Fill me. He does it. It's promised. Now all those who believed were together and had all things in common and sold their possessions and goods. Ooh, people get and divided. They divided their things and gave to those in need as such had need. So continuing daily with one accord. Here it is again, 46 verses later. So continuing together daily with in one accord. How are we in one accord? When we're focused on Christ. Not when we're being busybodies, not when we're trying to gossip, not when we're trying to find somebody to get into their business, not when we're self-centeredly thinking just about me, myself, and I, but when we're focused on Christ. We come together, we focus on Christ. One accord in the temple, breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God, having favor with all the people, and the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved. We don't do it. He does it. But we become willing vessels when we turn our life and will over to Him.
All right. Well, as always, there's always a bunch of good stuff to come out of the Word, right? One of the things that strikes me that I was just over here speaking with this, I don't know you by first name. Go ahead and say it.
Debbie
was talking about this, is how amazing it is that she's been in the church for so many years and she's tried so hard to act like a child of God without actually trusting God to create her to be that child of God. And that's exactly what the Alpha Series helps us to understand. Again, over and over and over, I feel like we're a broken record, Bob and I, sometimes, because there's nothing more clear in the entire gospel than being led of the Spirit, allowing God to lead. Jesus told the disciples, I'm going to go be seated at the right hand of the Father. Another helper, one just like me, is going to come live in you and guide you. And this is what was going on here, even before. Let's just go through and fill in some blanks. But one of the things, I got a comedic bone in me, right? So, Bob, I always thought that that God had a Plymouth. But Bob told me that all disciples were all in a Honda, all in one accord. See, where I read it, God drove Adam and Eve from the garden in his fury. So, maybe they, later on, I'm sorry, I just had to do it. On the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit came as a powerful wind. And actually, there's this, it's funny because Spirit, Wind, and Fire, there's a church that the Crossing used to be in, and the church took over that old building, and it's called Spirit Wind. And I'm thinking, that's a cool name for a church, Spirit Wind. And when we sing one of our songs, we sang it last week, Born Again Child, Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit Wind. That's the feeling I'm under. And what it creates, he said, there's a flame rested on each apostle's head. I'm going to fill in some blanks. People from many countries were astonished to hear them speaking of the wonderful works of God in their own native language. We see what happens with us, and it happens all the time, and there's a lot of well-meaning programs and things to get involved with. And I've got involved with a lot of spiritual retreats over my lifetime, and some were based in Catholicism, and some were based in Lutheranism, and some were based in a lot of other things. And as much as they say going in, look, we just want to make it bottom line, it's about Jesus, take all your denominational colors off and leave them at the door, but the deeper you get involved with these systems, the more you realize they're trying to train you up in their denominational belief system, not in a Spirit-led, necessarily, life of Christ without the performance. So many times, it's like, I go in, and I was involved for years, and then after a while, they found out I was actually a pastor. And they were so surprised because I don't dress right. I don't wear the robes. I don't wear the collars. And a lot of times on the weekends that I was on, I'd be in shorts and a T-shirt, and I'd be barefoot. And so the one guy who was a team leader this one time invited me, and he said, hey, I'd like you to come as a clergy leader. I said, oh, cool, I'll be there as a clergy. Well, you're a pastor, right? I said, well, yeah, I've been a pastor for about 7-8 years now, yeah. Okay, well, we'd like you to come on as clergy. Well, I've never done a clergy leadership on a team before. So my initial response was, let me call some of these other clergy that have done it and see if there's something I should know to be aware of, because I want to do what's appropriate. I asked the team leader, I said, how do you want me to dress? Do you want me to come in a suit? Do you want me to come like I always am? Do you want me to be casual and comfortable? You're the team leader. I am here to serve your team. You come comfortable. You come as you want. But you know what? When it's your day to talk, why don't you put a suit on that day and come in like the pastor? Okay, like the pastor. And I put suits on. I know you haven't seen me in a much, but if you've been at a wedding or a funeral and they've asked me to wear a suit, I'll be there in a suit. So anyway, the whole weekend, people, because I was barefoot, because I was in my shorts, and people like, oh, you're part of the team. Yeah, I'm part of the team. What's your role? Oh, I'm clergy. You're clergy? Yeah. Oh. Where are your shoes? They're in my room. Well, you can't come in here without shoes. What was really weird was the only reason I didn't have shoes is because I dropped the lawnmower on my left foot before the night before I was going on the weekend, and I had an injured foot, so I couldn't even fit in a shoe. But nobody noticed the big old swollen foot. They were just all about, you know, how dare you come into this building without shoes on? And anyway, it was really strange for me. But what happened to me is I heard all this judgment, all this looking down. You know that the Bible says that the Lord hates a haughty look? H-A-U-G-H-T-Y, haughty. You ever give somebody one of them looks when they walk by? Oh, God. That's the stuff he hates. Catch yourself next time because you're in judgment. But what I found myself doing is I'm going to the scripture and I'm going to go prove these guys that they shouldn't be doing this and they shouldn't be doing that. And I'm ripping through the scripture and I'm taking notes. Wait till they hear this scripture? Wait till they hear that one? And I realized that I was up half the night doing the same thing they were doing in reverse. I was judging them and looking down on them because they weren't doing what I thought they should be doing. How's that for a catch-22, huh? And I realized, I said, you know what? You're just as arrogant as they are in your own personal belief system. And I've found, especially in the last few months here, disappointments with people. And I was talking to Mark about it this morning. You know, I get disappointed with people because of one thing, expectations. And I had these great expectations for people because I expected them to do what I would do. Anybody been there besides me? Yeah. Well, how come they don't hold the door for me? I would hold it for them, and they don't hold it for me, scumbags. Wait, you're not supposed to say scumbags. It's okay to think it, though, right? No. Catch yourself. When these people all came together, what happened is all the differences got set aside because they actually were in one spirit. They actually were in one accord. They were all together. And I love this scripture, and I'd be darned if I know where it is, but it's my favorite scripture, and I want to put it big, maybe back on our next banner. Put aside all disputable things. Stop arguing over useless junk. The sky is blue. And you might come to me and say, well, no, it's actually gray. No, it's azure. Well, no, it's actually kind of purple. And we could sit and argue and argue and argue and never find common ground. But what they found in God was common ground. And the intent of a lot of people when they do these spiritual weekends is to put aside all denominationalism and let's come in as one being and one body. Great plan. But if you're putting your plan above God's, it's not going to work. Okay, God, what do I do? I find myself frustrated in a lot of situations with a lot of different people. And if my first thing is, well, they did this and they did that and they didn't do this and they didn't do that and they should have done this and they should have done that. And I'm going, wait a minute. You know what? That isn't their fault. This is my issue. I had expectations. And you know what? I can't go back in history. I can't go back and change it. So I will do what I can do. And that's all I can do. And if I do what I do and don't worry about everybody else, then things will be just fine. And I hated hearing it when I was a kid because I used to gripe about other people that I worked with, how they didn't do what they were supposed to do, and I was doing all the work, and they weren't doing any of the work. And you know the Bible says if you keep on backbiting each other, you'll chew each other up, and you won't be left at all. There'll be nothing there. The worst thing you can hear within the body of a church is backbiting. And I think that what most people find here is that we accept right where you are. And it's only because we keep on pushing, you better be led of God because you're fallible. And I have to do it too. And if I'm not honest with you and I'm pretending I'm all that, then right from the leadership all the way down, it's going to come through the body like a plague. I am just as fallible. I do the same things. I find myself in judgment and I go, God, what is all this? I'm so frustrated. I just want to choke these people. Well, who do you think you are? You do what you're called to do. And don't worry about other people. That's where I'm at. So that day, when they were in one accord, when God actually was in control, God brought 3,000 people that gave their hearts to God because they saw something that was real. They saw something that wasn't the usual. It wasn't the norm. Wow. The new believers continued to learn from the apostles. Now, here's a problem that happened in the scriptures. Jesus actually talked to the Pharisees and the Sadducees about this. He said, you know, you people, and he called them a lot of times hypocrites. He called them packs of vipers. He said they were like sepulchers where they whitewashed the outside to look real pretty, but the inside was still nasty and rotten and full of foul flesh. And they were the religious leaders. And the harshest thing that I remember him saying is this: you people will go halfway around the world to make a convert for me, and then you'll train them to be twice the sons of hell that you are. And that sounds pretty harsh, doesn't it? Train somebody to be twice the sons of hell that you are. Well, if somebody said that to me, I'd be angry. Why are you calling me a son of hell? Why are you calling me that? Here's why it was going on. Because the Pharisees and Sadducees were trying to get people to go back under their religious performance trap. Well, I know that God saved you, but now if you don't do this and you don't do that, and if you keep doing this and you keep doing that, then you're going to go to hell anyway. You're not God's stuff if you're fallible still. Not true. God says he created us. He knows our frame. That's why he sent the Savior, because he knows each and every one of us needs it. And I need him today more than I needed him 22 years ago, only I didn't know it then. 22 years ago, I was desperate and didn't know what to do. For the first 9 or 10 or 11 years of me being saved, I was doing what my friend over here was doing, performing, trying to fit into this new world called Christianity. I knew how to deal with people in the drug houses. I knew how to deal with people on the street. I knew how to deal with people in the bars. I just don't know how to perform right to fit in at church. So now what do I got to do? You go into performance mode. How do I dress? What do I say? What don't I say? Don't tell anybody about those old deep dark secrets, because they might find out that you're real. And you're not supposed to be real if you're a plastic Christian. I had to get real. Some of it happened through some of those spiritual renewal weekends. Some of it happened through leadership training that weren't Christian renewal weekends. Some of it happened through my own experiences. Some of it happened because I had to get honest when I saw myself in the mirror and saw that I was an arrogant, self-centered, raging jerk at times. And what I saw in myself was, oh my God, you're just like your dad. And no wonder I hated myself. How could I be the very thing that I told myself I never want to be? I don't ever want to be like him. And here's what I learned in some of this training through Alpha and some of my spiritual training. So many times when we get our head focused on I don't want to be like him, the part that we settle on is like him. And you try so hard not to be like him that you turn into just like him or her. But what I discovered about 10 years ago is, guess what? I got a brand new dad. And I want to be just like him. I do want to be like him. That's the best dad I've ever had. And my dad,
you know, in my opinion, in my experience, I have my emotional stresses that happened from my childhood just like you have from yours. Only my dad was just as wounded as I am. And I started to learn how to have compassion for him instead of anger. Because for him to become the person he was, what did he have to go through in his childhood? Something really simple could have changed his life. Something that happened when he was 4 or 5 years old could have wounded him that he lived with the rest of his life. See, in all the teaching that we do through Alpha, the teaching that we do in Boundaries, the teaching that we do in Recovery, my anger issues, my frustration, my hatred for people who wounded me in my life, you know what? It wasn't them that's the problem. It was my problem. And this is what I learned in my Clemmer and Associates training. If you have a problem, what are you going to do about it? It's your problem. You better own it. Quit blaming other people. You can spend the rest of your life saying, well, it's his fault that I turned out like this. And you're deflecting responsibility. You know what? You're a grown man. Deal with it. That's what I had to hear. That's your issue. What are you going to do about it? Well, I don't want to keep living with it. Okay. How are you going to deal with it? Don't know. 12-step program says, how are you going to get rid of your frustration? Here's the answer. We're going to ask God to remove it. Wow. Can't be that easy. Yeah, it is. How are you going to get rid of your anger? Going to ask God to remove it. How are you going to get rid of your dysfunction? Going to ask God to remove it. How are you going to get rid of your addiction? Going to ask God to remove it. How are you going to get done with your rage? Same answer. Can't be that easy. Nope, you're right. It can't be if you don't have a faith. If you don't believe that God's good, you'll never run to God when you need help. But when you start to understand how good God is, you'll start running to him every time. Help me, God. I'm frustrated, I'm tired, I'm angry, I'm judgmental, I'm hateful, I'm raging. I want to choke that person and I don't know what to do about it. God, help me. It's the best and only hope you have. Yeah, but he did this and he did that and she did this and she did that. Judgment, condemnation, it ain't your job. He didn't call us to be judges. He called us to be lovers. Well, how do you love somebody you hate? Can't. How do you love the unlovable? Only by the strength of God. Only by understanding that you're just as fallible as they are. Yeah, but I never did this, that, and the other. Here's one of my run-ins I had. And as horrible as it sounds, and we all have these judgments like which is worse and which is better, I had a friend of mine that was coming to my house pretty regular, and then all of a sudden he stopped coming for a while, and my wife and my daughter were very uncomfortable with him around the house sometimes, and I didn't understand why, and I was trying to help him in ministry because that's what I'm supposed to do as a Christian. I'm going to do whatever I can to help this brother, and whether my family's uncomfortable or not. You're going to have to deal with it because I'm the pastor here. How's that? Let me get that crown now, right? Well, he stopped coming around for a while, and the next time I saw him, his face was on the front page of the newspaper, and he was arrested for child molestation. And at first, I went right into judgment and anger and hatred. At first, I did what we all would do. I went to my wife and daughter. Did he ever do anything to you? Did he ever touch you? Because if he did, I'm going to go after him. And that's a horrible thing. But listen to how God handled it. I kept on feeling like I was supposed to go visit him in jail. And I'm like, I don't know that I want to. And he said, you're no better than him. This is what I was going on in my heart and in my head. What do you mean I'm no better than him? Have you ever taken advantage of anybody weaker than you? Ever? Well, yeah, but that's not the same. No, it's exactly the same. You have done the same thing. Don't get on your high horse and think you're all that. You've taken advantage of somebody weaker than you. It might just be in a business deal where they didn't understand the value of something they had. And man, I scooped right in and got that deal, boy. You've done the same thing. Quit being so judgmental. And it opened my heart up to go and accept him back and say, dude, the whole world is against you and I know you need a friend. I'm here. changed everything for me. Didn't change the situation, it changed my attitude. That's what God does. It'll get you off your high horse. Learn from the apostles, praise God. Fellowship and break bread together. This is, you know, the old church wasn't like this. I know you can come here and have breakfast and we're breaking bread together, but that isn't what the old church was. There wasn't church buildings and stuff. The church would be a gathering of believers who got together and they ate together. And if God put something on somebody's heart, they'd share it. If it was a song, they'd share it. If it was a poem, they'd share it. If it was a story or a revelation, they'd share it. That's what the church was. It wasn't a preacher sharing God's word. It was a bunch of believers sharing what God was doing in their midst. And that's how he grew the family. So time out for the trip in. God, sometimes Bob fills these in, sometimes I do. This week it happened to me, but this is kind of what I got out of it. I put these in the first person so you can read them for you. Have I had a personal experience with God in which I heard from him as I needed to? See, did I hear from him in my language? One of the times I heard from God in my language was when I passed a homeless guy on the street and I heard, go give that guy an apple. And I'm like, I'm not going to give him an apple. This one's breakfast, that one's lunch. I'm arguing with God. I got to the next slide and I heard it again. Go feed that guy an apple. No, I'm not going to do it. The third time, it was in my language. Dude, you have two. He don't have any. And it's like, God called me dude? But that's what I needed to hear. I needed to hear it in my own lingo. Go feed him an apple. You're missing something here. And that's when it changed my life. You know, that's when I understand. It's what I needed to hear, how I needed to hear it. Just like when I heard God say, if you want my help, ask. Where'd that come from? And whose help should I ask for? I didn't know God was. God, if you're real, do something. I heard it the other night on a movie. God, if you're real, do something. I don't know who God is. That was my biggest confession. I don't know who God is. And God said, if you want to know, just ask. And it really became that simple. In receiving the Spirit of God, what happened to you that changed you from the inside out? What was your experience? Because that's what you're going to have to share with other people. Not you have to share it. That's what you're going to have to share with other people. How did God deal with you? What happened in your life? Have you been resurrected and raised from the dead? I was 22 years ago. We talked about it a couple weeks ago. Let me show you my wounds. I was a rager. I was manipulative and controlling. I was extremely judgmental. I had huge expectations for others. I was frustrated all the time. I had to be in control. God killed that guy. God allowed him to die so I could be raised up, a brand new creation, resurrected to walk in newness of life, trusting God. Bob brought this up. Be filled with the Spirit. I want to tell you how the scripture goes. Be filled with the Spirit always. Are you one of those people who says, well, Satan's really doing this and Satan's really doing that and, you know, I'm not sure, but when I do good things, I better watch out because Satan's trying to attack me. I want to remove that from your vocabulary. If you're filled with the Spirit always, if you allow yourself to be filled with the Spirit always, filled, is there room for Satan in your life? The answer is no. Quit giving him credit for what God's doing. Yes, there's going to be difficult times. God says, even though it looks like it's meant for your harm, I'm going to work it for your good. Trust me. Walk through it. I am not going to allow harm to come to you. You got to get a hold of that. Here's the next question. What am I doing in response to his Spirit? Do I allow him to lead still? Or was it just one of those moments where, oh, good, I'm saved. Now I can keep doing what I want. Why would you do that? If God was that good on the day of your salvation, here's the way it is in the scripture. If God was good to us while we were his enemy, how much better is he going to be to us when we're his friend? You don't have to fear God. Well, the Bible says to have a healthy fear of God. Yeah. fearing God was before you were saved. After you've accepted God as your friend, you don't have to fear him at all. There's nothing to fear. He's your best friend. Yes, he's mighty. Yes, he's powerful. But you don't have to fear him at all. He's on your side. And he wants what's best for you always. So as we close up here, Bob mentioned two words, grieving and quenching. Grieving the spirit is this. You hear from God. God says, look, when you get out of here, take a right, go about 3 miles and take a left. And you go, great plan, God. And you go out of here and you take a left. Not that God gets mad at you. Grieving has nothing to do with anger. It has to do with a sense of loss. Loss of fellowship, I think, is one. And also grieving has to do with a sense of pain. God knows what you're going to have to go through when you're not following him. And he feels your pain. It's not going to be easy. Oh, there he goes. You ever have a child that you say, you know, I wish they wouldn't do that, and they go right ahead and do it, and you go, oh, no. It's kind of like that. And here's quenching the spirit. Well, I think God's called me to open up a church at Archie's. You know how many times I heard, you can't do church in a bar. If I'd have listened to everybody but God, this would never happen 10 years ago. Quenching the spirit means watering it down. I think God wants me to do that. What do you think? What do you think? What do you think? What do you think? And you're doing that really because you're trying to hear something that you want to hear instead of hearing God. Well, I'm not sure God wants me doing that. It would have been a lot easier, trust me, 11 years ago for me to go, nah, I don't think God's called. I'm not called to that. I love that one. I'm not called to that. Really? Did you hear God? Yeah, but so many other people said I shouldn't that I'm going to listen to them instead. Bad idea. Don't quench the spirit. Quit watering it down. If God says do it, trust him and do it. It's really that simple. How do I know? Because here I am 22 years later, and my experience is he has never failed me. Never. 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 How long is never? Never. Get it? Good. As we close this morning, Kat and Doug are set up for communion. Maybe you've never accepted this spirit. That's okay. Nobody hates you. Nobody's casting you out. God loves you. He's been loving you all along. He sent his son to forgive you over 2,000 years ago. Do you want to accept it yet or not? That's really what it's about, accepting the forgiveness that happened for all of us 2,000 years ago. If you want to, you're welcome to come to the table and say, I accept it. God, Jesus, what you did for me, I don't understand, but I need you. That's simple. So as we close up, I want to pray for you the same prayer that Jesus had for his disciples and all of us. Father, it is my biggest desire that you would show them that they are one with us, like I am one with you. We are one in the Spirit. We're united only because of you, God, because you created us, because you made a way for us to be forgiven and accepted. And God, because you will place your spirit in us and lead us and guide us into unity, not division. Father, I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So anybody like the Beatles, this is my rendition of the Beatles song, Let It Be. Only a couple little words have changed, but I think you'll catch them.
In times of trouble, my Lord Jesus rescues me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. And in my hour of darkness, he is standing right in front of me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. Let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be. Let it be. Whispers words of wisdom, let it be. And when the broken-hearted people living in the world can see that Jesus is the answer, let it be. For though they may be blinded, there is still a chance that they can see that Jesus is the answer, let it be. be, let it be, let it be, let it be. Jesus is the answer, let it be. Oh, let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be. 'Cause Jesus is the answer, let it be.
I know that for sure. Yeah. Uh-oh. Cousin Vern came out of the woods.
Some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away, I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away in the morning when I die, hallelujah, by and by. I'll fly away when the shadow of this life have gone. I'll fly away like a bird from prison bars has flown. I'll fly away, away. I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away when I die, hallelujah, by and by.
Somebody come out here and do that Appalachian half step or whatever the heck they call it. Come on, you can do it. I need a longer beard.
Oh, how glad and happy when we meet. I'll fly away. No more cold unshackles on my feet. I'll fly away.
Like I'm free.
I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away in the morning when I die, hallelujah, by and by. I'll fly away.
Where are you, Vern? Get it, Cousin Zeke.
just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away to a land where joy shall never end. I'll fly away.
Sing it!
I'll fly away, oh glory,
up his sleeves, he ain't his foot.
Oh, I believe.
There's thunder in his footsteps and lightning in his fist.
Our God is an awesome God.
And the Lord wasn't joking when he kicked them out of Eden. It wasn't for no reason that he shed his blood. His return is very soon, so you better be believing that our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. When the skies were starless in the void of the night,
our God is an awesome God.
He spoke into the darkness and created the light.
Our God is an awesome God.
Judgment and wrath, he brought it down on Sodom. Mercy and grace he gave us at the cross. I hope that we have not too quickly forgotten that our God is an awesome God.
Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God.
He reigns
from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God.
Our God is an awesome God.
Kittens. Get your free kittens. Get your free kittens. They're free today, but they'll cost you the rest of their lives. Yes, they will. Free kittens. And they turn into cats, too.
Ha ha. That guy right there.
One for the people? Is this one for the Lord? Or do I simply serenade for things I must afford? You can jumble them together, the conflict still remains. For holiness is calling in the midst of courting fame. 'Cause
as I see the trust in their eyes.
Though the sky is falling,
they need your love in their lives.
Compromise is calling.
What if I stumble and what if I fall? What if I lose my step and I make fools of us all? Will the love continue when my walk becomes a crawl? What if I stumble? Me, for I cannot compose the fear that lives within me or the rate at which it grows. If struggle has a purpose on the narrow road you carved, why do I fear my trespasses will leave a deadly scar? Do they see the fear in my eyes?
Are they so revealing?
This time I cannot disguise
all the doubt.
What if I stumble and what if I fall? What if I lose my step and I make fools of us all? Will the love continue when my walk becomes a crawl? What if I stumble and what if I? What if I stumble and what if I fall? What if I lose my step and I make fools? Everyone's got to crawl when you know that you're up against a wall, just about to fall. Everyone's got to crawl when you know that. Well, everyone's got to crawl when you know that you're up against a wall, just about to fall. Everyone's got to crawl when you know that. Well, I hear you whisper my name.
You say
my love for you will not change.
Never change.
But what if I stumble and what if I fall? What if I lose my step and I make fools of us all? Will the love continue when the walk becomes a crawl? What if I stumble and what if I? Well, what if I stumble and what if I fall? What if I lose my step and I make fools of us all? Will the love continue when my walk becomes a crawl? What if I stumble?
In the words of my friend Bob Nelson as Epi Epperman, that's it! Okay. Look him up on the internet, bobnelson.com. He's a good, clean comedian. Have a great Sunday. I'm exhausted. I'm going home, and I have tons of work to do. How you like that? Have a great Sunday. Enjoy yourself, and remember, be filled with the Spirit.